Hey, I'm Bob and I like to make stuff. Today I'm going to make a Joy-Con holder that also stores your games. For Christmas this year, our family got a Nintendo Switch, and it's very, very cool. One of the things I like most about it is that the Joy-Con controllers come off so you can play in different configurations. One of the things I don't really like about it is that these tiny, tiny games come in these big packages. So today I'm gonna make some sort of contraption to hold the controllers and a whole bunch of games in a small package. Let's do it.
First off, I used some digital calipers to take measurements off the existing rail and then drew out a really simple profile sketch in Fusion 360. I extruded this sketch out just to about a half of an inch. I just wanted to make sure that this profile would fit around the real controller before printing the full thing. Having a short piece like this made it print a lot faster, which made it really easy to make adjustments and try again. It turned out that the first piece that I printed fit over the rail really well. But there's several different features that have to be accounted for. The extra buttons, there's some little hooks and notches to make things fit and slide correctly. I extruded it out to the full length and then started adding cutaways to match some of the hooks that are on the controller itself. When you're looking at a screen capture like this, it kind of looks like magic. Like I just knew where to put everything and it fit perfectly the first time. But the key is really some simple, precise measurement. And if you're trying to model something to fit on an object that's already in the real world, using calipers is a fantastic way to get the precision that you need. Excluding the print time, I spent about 2 hours making different versions of this and adding features, and eventually got something good.
I printed out 6 different iterations of this rail. This is the final one and it works really well. It slides on, there's plenty of friction to hold it in place, but you can easily get it off when you're ready to. I'm gonna make the file for this available so you can download it and use it in your own projects, but for me, this is just the first step in a bigger project here. And that project is making a container for the games. The games come in this nice big case, but they're actually really tiny. It's a huge waste of space to store something like this, so I'm gonna make a container that goes in between the controllers that can hold several little games. And a little word of warning, this project is gonna use digital fabrication tools that I understand not everybody has access to, but hopefully it will give you some inspiration and you can seek out some local ways to use those tools, either in a library or a local makerspace. All right, let's get to it.
To get started on the box for the games, I drew out some two-dimensional shapes in Illustrator, but you could also use Inkscape, it's completely free. I sent these shapes to my laser cutter and cut them out of 1/8-inch maple plywood.
I cut all these pieces out on the laser and I'm ready to put the box together, but I want to point something out. You could certainly make this box with traditional woodworking tools, no problem, but one thing that I found is really awesome about these newer digital fabrication tools is that you can make iterations very quickly and very easily. Also, if you were to try to cut a piece this small on a table saw, there's a pretty good chance it wouldn't come out like you wanted and it would be kind of dangerous. Anyway, in my case, I made the first box and then realized that some of the sizes were a little bit off, so I just modified my files and had the laser recut these pieces. These digital fabrication tools are awesome for incremental design and being able to make small changes very quickly.
The plywood that I used came covered in masking tape, and that's really so you can easily remove the scorched effect around the engraving. I peeled that off and used some super glue to put these together. This wood was also pre-finished, so I did have to sand some of the areas where it was going to be glued together to get a better hold. You could certainly use wood glue here as well, and you definitely want to make sure that you get rid of the finish if you're going to do that. The CA glue will hold onto the finish, but the wood glue really needs to penetrate into the fibers. I lined up these pieces roughly, but the outside of this is going to get sanded so that you can see the wood grain instead of just the burn marks from the laser. The masking tape peels off of large areas very easily, but using something really sticky like Gorilla Tape helps pull off all the small areas to get the better detail.
This video is sponsored by Honey, which is a free browser extension that I've been using for well over a year. The thing that's awesome about Honey is while you're shopping online, it goes out and finds the best coupon for what you're already buying, applies the coupon automatically, and then shows you how much you're saving. Honey is completely free and it only takes 2 clicks to install it. And if you don't use it, you're basically just throwing away money. I use it all the time shopping on Amazon and eBay and Newegg, but it's also available on tons of other sites like walmart.com and a bunch of travel sites. It works in all the major browsers. It's very easy to install. And like I said, it's free, so there's really no reason not to do it. If you want to try it out, go to joinhoney.com/ILTMS and check it out. That's joinhoney.com/ILTMS. Thanks, Honey.
Back on the laser, I cut another set of pieces that look almost identical, but they're actually smaller. These are for the tray that holds the games, and they're gonna fit inside my box. The belt sander was really helpful here too to get rid of the burn marks, but also to round over the edges to make sure that it slid really well once I dropped it into the box. Back in Illustrator, I drew out the art for the foam that fit inside the tray. And part of this was using the calipers to measure the games and figure out an opening where your finger could go in behind the game to pop it out. I cut this shape out of 2mm craft foam and I made two layers of it so that I could sandwich them together to get enough height. I scraped off the excess super glue from the inside of my tray before gluing down the first layer of foam. I grabbed the CA glue because it was right there, but as soon as I put it down, I realized that that was not the best choice. Mostly, I just used too much glue, but there was a lot of squeeze out that I had to try to clean up, and so for the second layer, instead of super glue, I used spray adhesive. I put on a light dusting, waved it around to let it dry a little bit, and stuck it right into place. I cut down a small scrap of wood to use for the top, but I had to get that lined up with the tray inside, so I added some super glue to the tray, dropped it in, and added activator to the top. As soon as those two pieces touch, they bond. This isn't the strongest connection in the world, but this thing's not going to take a lot of abuse. But I was really happy to see that the top was going to stay in place and the games fit nicely enough that they wouldn't fall out of the foam. When I made the shapes for the tray, I left a little wiggle room on the sides, and to fill that gap, I cut down some more small pieces of foam. These were actually a little tough to cut at that small size, so I did a couple of different fittings, and once I got one piece ready, I covered the back of it with some spray adhesive and fitted into the side and pressed it in place with a screwdriver. And this did two things. It kept the tray centered, but also gave it a nice friction fit. The outside faces were pre-finished, but I added some spray lacquer to all the edges that I had sanded before. Then I printed out the final rails.
What happened, Bob?
Ran out of filament.
Eventually, I did get both of the rails printed and then moved on to adding them to the box. I found the smallest screws that I had, but they were still too long. So first, I laid the rails in place and marked where the holes were going to be. I pre-drilled these out to avoid splitting my box in half when I put in the screws. I dropped the screws through the rail and held them in place so that I could mark how long they needed to be. For the first screw, I held it with some pliers up against the belt sander and wore it down till it was the right length. Then I realized that since it was brass, I could just use some nippers and cut it off. Since these didn't have a tip anymore, pre-drilling those holes really helped get the screws started. The only thing that really matters here is that the screw heads are completely flush with the bottom, so they don't scrape up the outside of the controller. I did the same thing for the other side, and then the rails were mounted.
I'm super happy with how this thing turned out for a lot of different reasons, but one of the coolest things about it is that it's actually multiple projects. If you just needed a case for your games, you could make a box like this and it would work just fine. If you wanted to make other sorts of crazy controllers, you can get these rails and attach them to anything you want. But in this case, it's really great to have them both together, have a really cool thing that you can hold and play on the couch, and I'm really happy that I was able to use the laser and a 3D printer, plus some traditional tools. The files for the rails are going to be linked down in the description. I would love it if you took them, made them better, used them, and I'd love to see what you make with them as well. If you're new to the channel, I've got lots and lots of other types of projects that you may be interested in, some of them using regular woodworking tools and some using 3D printers and all that type of stuff. Be sure to check those out here, and don't forget to subscribe. That's it for this one, guys. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time. This is the fifth iteration of... sixth. This is number six. This is the number six that sounds stupid.